Hi, welcome all to the online classes for BTech AG 4th semester agriculture. And on the last one, we had started with the topic of insulator, semiconductor, and conductors. And we had discussed the difference between these materials on the basis of their energy band diagrams and the electronic configuration. And we had completed till to the semiconductor and types of semiconductor. And we had discussed the semiconductors are of two types. First is pure semiconductor and second is impure semiconductor, or intrinsic type semiconductor and extrinsic type semiconductor. So we had completed with intrinsic type semiconductor and extrinsic type semiconductor or impure type semiconductor is basically a doped semiconductor. So we are going to start with extrinsic type semiconductors. Most of the engineering application of semiconductors involves doped semiconductor with specified impurities rather than intrinsic materials. Doping is the process of adding a controlled quantity of impurity to intrinsic semiconductor so as to increase its conductivity. Because we had seen that in the pure form of semiconductor, the conductivity is low. So to increase the conductivity, when the research is done, they add some specific impurities or doping of atoms into the another atom and see the analysis and the results. They come to find out that the conductivity is increased, and that conductivity plays a great importance in the use of semiconducting material, doped semiconducting material. And further, when they do the research on that, in how, in what way it can be used or can be used as an application for different tasks, they are unable to get some conclusion for the use of semiconductor, doped semiconductors. And further, when they do the research by creating the doped semiconductors, and I had already discussed that the semiconductor or doped semiconductor is of two types. First is P type and second is N type. So on the various research, when they generate P type semiconductor or N type semiconductor, and in further continuation to that research, when they diffuse or join these two semiconductors to each other and do the analysis and research, they come to some conclusion that the device or the element which is formed after diffusing two doped semiconductors, that is P and N type, result in a semiconductor device, and that particular device has specific characteristic, and that characteristic is most importantly known as switching. So we had seen the mechanical switches, and that mechanical switches can be easily controlled or a human labor is required to control the mechanical switches. But whatever the device is formed after diffusing two doped semiconductor, that is p-type or n-type semiconductor, that particular element is also behave like a switch or a valve. That means when we do the biasing or when we do the connection, we found that it allows the current in one direction and blocks the current in reverse direction. So due to its switching property, it has tremendous application in electronic circuitry. And due to this invention, the scenario of the electronics engineering is almost get changed, and the life of the human being get drastically changed by this small semiconductor device. And that particular semiconductor device is known as diode. So we will see in the next continuation of this topic. So I'm going to start with doped or extrinsic semiconductor. How the doped and extrinsic semiconductors are formed, and what is the internal physics play a role inside the extrinsic semiconductors, and what is the internal physics means to say that the behavior of electrons and how the current flows and who are playing the major role in the conduction of electricity or current conduction or electric conduction. So most of the engineering application of semiconductors involve doped semiconductors with the specified impurities rather than intrinsic material. Doping is the process of adding a control quantity of impurity to intrinsic semiconductor so as to increase its conductivity. A semiconductor doped with impurity atom is called an extrinsic semiconductor. The impurity is added to the melt of germanium or silicon, then the crystal is grown in which the impurities are incorporated. The impurity atom occupy lattice positions which were occupied by germanium atoms in pure metals. Two types of extrinsic semiconductors are produced depending upon the group of impurity atom. Next, n-type semiconductor. So I had already told you that extrinsic semiconductor is of two type. First is n-type semiconductor and second is p-type semiconductor. Now what is this n-type semiconductor? Consider crystal of germanium in which a small fraction of germanium atom is replaced by antimony atoms. So germanium crystal is of fourth group element, and a small fraction of germanium atom is replaced by antimony atom, and where the antimony atom is of fifth group element. So you mean to say that you are adding fifth group element into the fourth group element, And the fourth group elements are known as the tetravalent atoms. And the fifth group elements are known as the pentavalent atoms. So the antimony atom is a pentavalent and it occupies normal germanium lattice sites. It forms four covalent bond with neighboring germanium atoms. So as you see in the figure, Sb atom forms the covalent bond with the germanium atoms, and it is a pentavalent atom. So that means in its outermost shell there are 5 electrons. So 4 electrons pair the covalent bonding with the germanium atom, and the 5th electron is considered to be the free electron. So this free electrons plays a vital role in the conduction of electricity. Now, as we observe the energy band diagram of n-type semiconductor, so we come to find out that valence band and the conduction band is designated with some sort of Sb ions or the donor level. So by observing this energy band diagram, it is clear to specify the valence electron also, and that valence electron or free electron plays a vital role in electrical conductivity. Next. The fifth electron not used in bonding is loosely bound with the supply of little energy. It can be made free, leaving behind a positively charged immobile ion. Thus, the impurity atoms donate free electrons to the crystal, thereby increasing the conductivity of material. Hence, they are called the donor impurities. So, in particularly n-type semiconductor, the free charges or free electrons are termed as donor impurities. The conductivity is due to the negatively charged electrons, hence the material is called n-type semiconductor. For electron hole pair, the electron and hole pairs are generated in germanium due to thermal energy. For n-type semiconductor, the concentration of free electron is far greater than concentration of holes. The addition of donor impurity generates new energy level in the band picture. The donor energy levels of neutral donor atoms lie very close to the lower edge of the conduction band. With the supply of little energy, the neutral donor atom loses the fifth electron for conduction, and it gets positively charged. P-type semiconductor. Now the second type of extrinsic semiconductor is P-type semiconductor. So P-type semiconductor, if the intrinsic semiconductor material, say germanium, is doped by atoms of trivalent element, that is trivalent element or third group element, when doped with fourth group element, then the semiconductor form is known as p-type semiconductor. For example, boron, then the impurity atoms occupy places in the lattice which were previously occupied by germanium in pure crystal. So by observing the diagram, if boron fits in the crystal lattice of germanium and it is a trivalent atom, so the three electrons form a covalent bond with the neighboring germanium atom, but when vacancy is there or boron is trying to form a covalent bond, but there is a deficiency of electron and it cannot form a covalent bond, and that deficiency is termed as to be free hole. So if I'm talking about the lattice structure, this is a one atom representation. So if I'm talking about a whole crystal lattice, then there are so many number of free electrons or free holes are to be present over there. And these free holes need to be filled up by electron, or we can say that this free electron or this free hole plays a role of conduction in electricity or conduction, electrical conduction. Now, the energy band diagram of this p-type semiconductor is shown by the atoms, and boron atom is shown with the electrons plus the intrinsic hole. So boron with accepted electron. The negatively charged ion is created, or we can say negatively charged ion is created. Left hole left by electron accepted. The acceptor level by the atom accepted by boron semiconductor. So this is the energy band diagram representation of p-type semiconductor. Boron is being trivalent, is one electron short of being able to complete the stable structure. The absence of electron in one of these bond is hole. With a small amount of energy, it can accept an electron from the neighboring germanium atom and the vacancy shifts there. The impurity atoms thus supply holes which are ready to accept electrons. Hence, the impurity is known as acceptor impurity. The hole concentration is much more. The hole concentration is much more than electron concentration thermally generated. The conductivity is due to the positively charged holes. Hence, the semiconductor is called p-type of semiconductor. The addition of impurity introduces additional acceptor energy level in the band diagram, slightly above the top of the conduction band. With the supply of little energy, these vacancy can be occupied by electrons in valence band, and thus increases the hole in valence band. It should be numbered that even though the conduction in p-type and n-type material is due to holes and electrons respectively, it does not mean that p-type material has a positive charge and n-type material has negative charge. The extrinsic semiconductors are electrically neutral at any given temperature. They are neutral at any given temperature. Now, the law of mass action for intrinsic type semiconductors and extrinsic type semiconductors. The law of mass action states that the product of number of electrons in the conduction band and the number of holes in the valence band is constant at fixed temperature and is independent of amount of donor and acceptor impurity added. Mathematically, it is represented as N into P equals to Ni square, where Ni is the intrinsic carrier concentration, Np is the number of electrons in conduction band, P is the number of holes in the valence band. This is very useful relation since for the given semiconductor, that is giving effective mass and energy gap, at a given temperature, the product of electron and hole concentration is constant. We have assumed that the semiconductor is intrinsic. The only assumption which has been is that the distance of the Fermi level from the edges of both the bands should be large in concentration with KBT. Due to this consideration, the result of equation will also apply to extrinsic semiconductor. Thus, introducing an impurity in intrinsic semiconductor to increase N, say, will decrease resistivity as the product must remain constant. Thus, the equation governs the relative concentration of electrons and holes in given semiconductor and is sometimes called the law of mass action. Law of mass action for extrinsic semiconductors. The law of mass action is applied for both intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductor. For extrinsic semiconductor, the law of mass action states that product of majority carriers and minority carriers is constant at fixed temperature and is independent of amount of donor and acceptor impurity added. Law of mass action for N-type semiconductor. So the law of mass action for N-type semiconductor is mathematically written as Nn Pn equals to Ni square, which is constant. Where Nn is equal to number of electrons in N-type semiconductor and where Pn is the number of holes in N-type semiconductor. So here we are just saying that the hole and electron concentration in N-type semiconductor or the product of hole and electrons in N-type semiconductor is again come out to be Ni square, that is equivalent to the intrinsic type semiconductors. The electrons are the majority carriers and the holes are the minority carriers in N-type semiconductor. In N-type semiconductor, as the number of electrons, majority in the conduction band increases the number of holes, minority in the valence band decreases. There the product of electrons and holes remain constant at the fixed temperature. Law of mass action for P-type semiconductor. The law of mass action for P-type semiconductor is mathematically written as PP NP is equals to Ni square, which is again constant. Where PP stands for number of holes in P-type semiconductor and NP stands for number of holes in P-type semiconductor. The holes are the majority charge carriers or the majority carriers in P-type semiconductors and electrons are the minority carriers in P-type semiconductor. In P-type semiconductor, as the number of holes that is in the majority in the valence band increases and the number of electrons in the conduction band that is in the minority decreases, therefore the product of holes and electron, that is majority into minority, remain constant at fixed temperature. Now, the concept of drift current. In semiconductor, there are two types of current exist. One is drift current and the another is diffusion current. So drift current, as the by name itself, indicating that drift current is the driven current or the forced current. Or diffusion current is the phenomena of diffusion takes place. As we had seen in the theory of gases, the higher concentration particles move to the lower concentration particles. So that is particularly known as the diffusion. And when we are going to add some dopants, so the diffusion of atoms takes place and the concentration of electrons or holes taking part, and due to that the concentration from higher end to the lower end, the movement of the charge carriers contribute the current, and that is known as the diffusion current. So drift current, the flow of charge carriers which is due to the applied voltage or electric field, is called drift current. In a semiconductor, there are two types of charge carriers. They are electrons and holes. When the voltage is applied to the semiconductor, the free electron move towards the positive terminal of the battery and the holes move towards the negative terminal of the battery. As per the phenomena of attraction, the positive or the like charge repel each other, or unlike charge attract each other. So the terminals are basically the anode and cathode, and they attract holes and electrons towards their respective side. Electrons are negatively charged particles and holes are the positively charged particles. As we had already discussed, that like charges repel each other and like charges attract each other. Hence, the electrons are attracted towards the positive terminal of a battery and the holes are attracted towards the negative terminal. In a semiconductor, electrons always try to move in a straight line towards the positive terminal of the battery. But due to the continuous collision with the atom, they change the direction of flow. As we know that whenever an applied field is put up across any material, then electrons start moving in a particular direction. But when electrons start moving in a particular direction, then obviously they start colliding with each other. In a particular direction. So due to that collision, their direction is somewhat not uniform. And the conductivity effects over there. Each time the electron strikes an atom, it bounces back in random direction. The applied voltage does not stop the collision and random motion of electrons, but it causes the electron to drift towards the positive terminal. But the process is still continue to move in a uniform direction, that is towards the positive terminal. So we need to take up the average velocity that an electron or hole achieved due to the applied voltage or electric field is called drift velocity. So if we are going to conclude that drift velocity is directly proportional to the applied electric field. So Vd is directly proportional to E. And as we know, the mobility and the electrons or holes start moving, so their mobility introduce So the proportionality sign is removed by the mu, which is known as the mobility. So drift velocity is given as Vd equals to mu e. So the drift velocity of electrons is given by Vn is equals to mu n e, and the drift velocity of holes is given by Vp equals to mu p e. So in the case of semiconductors, the drift current is given as I equals to In plus Ip, and these are the some notation standing for the Vn, mu n. Vn drift velocity of electron, Vp drift velocity of holes, mu n mobility of electrons, mobility of holes, and E is the applied electric field. The drift current density due to free electrons is given by this. Now, if I'm talking about the drift current density, this is given by Gn and Jp, respectively for free electrons and free holes. Next, the total drift current density is given as J equals to Gn plus Jp, and is given as E equals to N mu n plus P mu p into E. So for calculating the drift current density for any extrinsic type semiconductors, we must have the concentration of electron and the concentration of hole and their respective mobility. Then we can conclude or be calculated the drift current density for any extrinsic type semiconductor. Electron and hole mobility. Electron mobility, the ability of electron to move or move through a metal or semiconductor in the presence of applied electric field is given, is called electron mobility. And then mathematically we had derived this formula, Vn is equal to mu n e, and mobility of electron is introduced by this formula. This mobility of electron have an effect of temperature also. Or we can say that it is affected by a temperature also. Let us consider semiconductor that consists of large number of free electrons. When there is no voltage or electrical field applied across the semiconductor, the free electrons move randomly. However, when voltage or electric field is applied across the semiconductor, each free electron starts to move more quickly in particular direction. Electrons move very fast in vacuum. However, in metals or semiconductors, free electrons do not move very fast. Instead, they move with finite average velocity called drift velocity. And I had already discussed the concept that is due to the collision. We need to calculate the average velocity. Drift velocity directly proportional to electric field. Hence, when the electric field increases, drift velocity also increases. However, mobility of electron is independent of applied electric field. That is, change in electric field does not change the mobility of electrons. The SI unit of electric field is volt per meter. And the SI unit of velocity is meter per second. The SI unit of mobility is given as meter square upon volt second. Hole mobility we had discussed. Now come to the diffusion current. The process by which charge carriers, electrons or holes in semiconductors move from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration is called diffusion. The region in which more number of electrons is present is called higher concentration region, and the region in which less number of electrons is present is called lower concentration of region. Current produced due to motion of charge carriers from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration is called diffusion current. Diffusion process occurs in semiconductor that is non-uniformly doped. So diffusion process occurs in a semiconductor. Consider an n-type semiconductor that is non-uniformly doped as shown in figure below. Due to the non-uniform doping, more number of electrons is present at the left side, whereas the lesser number of electrons is present at the right side of the semiconductor material. The number of electrons present left side of the semiconductor material is more, so these electrons will experience a repulsive from each other. And the diffusion of electrons takes place from higher concentration to the lower concentration. And almost uniform concentration of electrons takes place. And till to the uniform concentration, the electrons are in the motion. And that motion results in current and known as diffusion current. The electron present at left side of the semiconductor material will move to the right side to reach the uniform concentration of electrons. Thus, the semiconductor material achieve equal concentration of electrons. Electrons that move from left side to right side will constitute current. This current is called diffusion current. In p-type semiconductor, the diffusion process occurs in similar manner. Both drift and diffusion current occurs in semiconductor devices. Diffusion current occurs without an external voltage or electric field applied. Diffusion current does not occur in a conductor. The direction of diffusion current is same or opposite to that of drift current. Concentration gradient. This is again important parameter in contrast to diffusion current. The diffusion current density is directly proportional to the concentration gradient. Concentration gradient is the difference in concentration of electrons or holes in given area. If the concentration gradient is high, the diffusion current density is also high. Similarly, if the concentration gradient is low, then the diffusion current density is also low. The concentration gradient for n-type semiconductor is given by Jn is directly proportional to dn by dx. The concentration gradient for p-type semiconductor is given by Jp is equals direct proportional to dp upon dx, where Jn is equals to diffusion current density due to electrons and Jp is equals to diffusion current density due to holes. Now, diffusion current density due to electrons is given by Jn equals to E, positive E, that is hole, the positive charge is here represented for the hole concentration. Dn, dn by dx, where dn is the diffusion coefficient of electrons. The diffusion current density due to holes is given by Jp equals to minus E, dp, dp by dx, where dp is the diffusion coefficient of holes. The total current density due to electrons in the sum of drift and diffusion current. Now, this is the total current in a semiconductor. And the total current is the summation of drift and diffusion current. So, drift current plus diffusion current is given as En mu n E plus E dn dn by dx. So the total current density due to holes is the sum of drift and diffusion current. So the above equation gives the total current density due to electrons, and the Jp gives the current density due to the holes, total current density. So the total current density due to electrons and holes is given by Gn plus Jp. So by adding these two terms, the equation is mentioned in standard books, which is a very large formula, and some of the time it is required to calculate the drift current and diffusion current or the total current. Now Ohm's law, as we know, Ohm's law states that a voltage is directly proportional to the current under the all physical quantity remain unchanged. So whenever the potential is applied, a voltage is applied across any conducting material, so as you apply the voltage in respect to that, current start increasing and it is directly proportional to the applied voltage under the all physical parameters remain unchanged. Here physical parameters remain means that normal temperature and pressure, under constant normal temperature and pressure. If there is a variation in temperature and normal temperature pressure, so the Ohm's law start diverting from its basic definition. So the Ohm's law was named after the German physicist George Ohm, who discovered this rule or law. Ohm's law states that the electric current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the applied voltage and inversely proportional to the resistance. So the proportionality sign is replaced by the resistance. In other words, the electric current flowing through a conductor increases if resistance is not changed, whereas the electric current flowing through a conductor decreases with increase in resistance of conductor if voltage is not changed. Ohm's law is mathematically written as I equals to V by R, or V equals to IR, or R equals to V by I. So the notation can be rearranged according to your need, but the specific definition notation is V is directly proportional to I, and the proportionality sign replaced by R, known as resistance of the conductor. Electric current, voltage and resistance definition. We all know that the definitions of these some parameters in earlier classes. The number of electrons flow through the conductor in 1 second is called electric current, I equals to dq by dt. Electric current is measured in amperes, the unit is ampere because it is given by ampere. Voltage, the difference in electric potential energy of charged particle between two points within the electric field is called voltage. So potential difference is known as voltage. The free electrons at the higher potential have more electrical potential energy, whereas the free electrons at lower potential have less electrical potential energy. Potential is measured or in volts, SI unit is volt. Resistance is the opposite force that resists the flow of electrons. So resistance is basically providing the hurdle, or it provides the blockage to oppose the forces. So the electrons that are moving freely through the conductor will collide continuously with an atom, which act as a barrier. This causes free electrons to lose their energy, hence the electrical energy or electrical decreases. Resistance is measured in ohms. The unit of resistance is ohm. The Ohm's law explanation with an example. The concept of Ohm's law is easily understood with the water analogy. the difference in water pressure between two points in a tank causes the water to flow. Here the difference in water pressure is compared with voltage or potential difference. The rate at which water flows per second is compared with electric current. The obstacle that decreases the water flow is compared with resistance. These are the some review questions. What is the basic difference between conductors and insulators? How do semiconductors differ from conductors and insulators? How many valence electrons does a conductor such as copper have? How many valence electrons does a semiconductor have? Name three of the best conductive material. So these are the some review questions or questionnaires which can be answered on the basis of their, on the basis of the knowledge we had gained. So, that is all for today. That is all for today's lecture. In next lecture, we are going to continue with the next topic, that is superconductors. So, after getting a sound knowledge of insulators, conductors, and semiconductors, we are going to start with superconductors. And superconductors are having a variety of applications and a very interesting topic. How any conductor behaves like a superconductor, or how any material can be converted into superconductors. The basic theme of superconductor is just only that a conductor which offers zero resistance. So any conductor which offers zero resistance is termed to be a superconductor. So it's a very important and very interesting topic. We will start into the next lecture. Thank you. Thank you. I hope that you all had enjoyed the topic. Thank you.